been hell on earth. We've been waiting for nearly 8 years.
Why do you think the story still resonates after so much time?
The largest, longest, most mysterious event in aviation history.
Is this the biggest break we've had?
It's a game changer.
That puts the plane where we think the point of impact was.
This is it.
It's massive.
That is a key that will help us unlock this mystery.
We've got to give it a red hot go.
Absolutely, we would stand ready to assist as we're asked.
If that doesn't say we need to search again, then I don't know what does.
We've been investigating the disappearance of flight MH370 for several years now. In 2020, we brought you the groundbreaking report, The Untold Story. Now, nearly 8 years after it went missing, there's been another breakthrough, and potentially a major one. The precise location of the aircraft. Surely now we owe it to the families for there to be one final search.
It's overwhelming to think that something so simple could actually solve this mystery nearly 8 years on. And it's heartbreaking for us, but the fact that something has come about and is so promising, we have to hold on to that because that's all we've got is hope.
Why do you think it's so important, Mike, to find it, to go again?
If for nothing else for the next of kin, we need to put this to bed. The only reason to keep looking is to find the flight recorder. An aircraft has gone missing and we don't know why.
Former Qantas captain Mike Glynn is on a mission. He wants another search launched for the plane and he believes he knows how to find it. WSPR.
Whisper, yeah.
May help us discover where MH370 is.
There's a good chance, yes. I think so.
Whisper is a network of weak radio signals that covers the globe. It's led to the creation of a revolutionary new tracking technology using the most unlikely of sources, amateur or ham radios.
Ham radio is a amateur radio operator using long-range radios.
And what's their purpose?
They talk to each other.
Around the world?
Around the world.
They're looking at aircraft. This one's here, this one's there.
Well, they're not even looking at aircraft. They're just talking to each other. They're logging who can talk to them and all this sort of thing. This whole idea about tracking aircraft was a very recent development.
With input from Captain Mike Glynn, British aerospace engineer Richard Godfrey developed the program. And this is how it works. Ham operators send out signals to see how far they travel. When it's received by another operator, it's logged into the Whisper database. Records go back to 2009. Where does MH370 fit in?
Well, people started thinking maybe with the knowledge that when aircraft pass through these links between these two stations, that sometimes they change the signal and that could be picked up.
These signals act like tripwires. If an aircraft flies through them, they can then be tracked. And it's precise. The signals are sent out every 2 minutes. This has now led to a much more detailed flight path for MH370 and, more importantly, its final resting place. It's the biggest breakthrough for a long time, right?
It's massive. It's massive. And, look, it's something we've been waiting for nearly 8 years. And, you know, there has been a hiatus with COVID, and which we understand, but it's also given, you know, these experts time to go back, sit down, run the numbers. You know, it's a connect the dots at this point. It really just blew my mind. It was have we found it? This is it. This is what we need.
Potentially, this is huge.
Potentially, very much so. Yes, I'd say it's a game changer because it introduces a whole new way of thinking about what actually happened.
To understand what happened, we need to go back to the beginning, to the launch pad of our investigation into MH370. In the history of aviation, there's never been a mystery like Malaysia Airlines Flight 370. It's so significant that that flight number, MH370, is known by most people. It was a modern passenger aircraft that took off from this runway in Kuala Lumpur on the 8th of March 2014 and simply vanished from the radars with its pilots, its crew, and its passengers on board. Even today, no one knows where it is, but much more is known about what happened, the alleged cover-ups, the investigative failures, and the possible motives of a pilot in command. It was business as usual at Kuala Lumpur International Airport. Nothing seemed out of the ordinary. Not the planes on the tarmac or the passengers in the terminal. Among those passing through security, Captain Zahari Ahmed Shah, followed by First Officer Farik Hamid, the pilots of MH370. One a junior, the other a veteran.
He has been flying on 777 as a captain since 1998, and he has clocked well over 16,000 flight hours, so a very senior captain.
MH370 with 777. Mm-hmm. It's a pretty decent aircraft.
It's a lovely aircraft.
So Captain Zahari Shah, he was on a very good airline in very good plane.
Yeah, and he was a type-rated examiner too, so he's at the top of the tree.
So pretty powerful position for him to be in.
And very trusted.
He had a lot of sway.
Yeah.
370, 32 right of takeoff. Nice. Please arrive, Captain Malaysia 371. Thank you.
At 12:42 in the morning, local time, Malaysia Airlines Flight 370 left the runway.
Good night, Malaysia 370, were the last words heard from anyone on that flight. And at the same time, the plane disappeared from radar screens.
The aircraft was supposed to land in Beijing at 6:30 a.m.
So were you still hoping that MH370 would still arrive in Beijing?
Yes.
6:30 a.m. in Beijing, when the plane should have landed. Delayed, flashed on the arrivals board. Panic sets in. The last point of contact was over the South China Sea, so that's where a search was launched.
Heard about the disappearance about 15 hours after it happened. I was up in Bangkok at the time.
Mike Glynn was flying back to Australia just after MH370 went missing. His flight took him over the South China Sea.
When I got there, there is a feature of the Gulf of Thailand where there are fishing boats, the entire length of the Gulf of Thailand. And you can see them at nighttime. It's one of the great sights in aviation. There's just this vast number of fishing boats there, and I'm going, there's no way an aircraft could crash here without being seen. There's absolutely no chance.
239 lives feared lost, including six Australian.
Australia's Prime Minister at the time was Tony Abbott.
I rang the Malaysian Prime Minister and I offered Australian assistance. At that stage, we thought that the plane had disappeared somewhere in the South China Sea.
But MH370 wasn't in the South China Sea. Primary radar records and Air Force data reveal when communication was lost, the plane turns back to Malaysia and flies for several more hours.
We are reassessing the redeployment of our assets.
When MH370 crosses from Malaysian to Vietnamese airspace, there's a catalogue of errors by air traffic controllers from both countries. At the same time, the plane's communications equipment was turned off.
That means you're not visible on civilian radar. And essentially, if you're not visible on civilian radar, nobody can see where you are.
Data showed once the plane flew across the Malay Peninsula, it turned around the island of Penang, headed up the Malacca Strait and across the Andaman Sea. It was even seen on military radar, but no one acts.
They had the opportunity when the Malaysian military tracked this plane for an hour. They did not scramble a jet to go and see what was going on. They could have saved us 8 years of pain and suffering. They didn't do that.
I think the initial response by the Malaysian government was, it took them a while to get organised.
There is this system which not even pilots knew about until MH370, which is that although he turned off all these systems he could turn off, there's one which emits via satellite data from engine performance. And the way it works is that, in this case, about every hour, there's a satellite handshake. The aircraft will send a signal to the satellite with data on it, and the satellite will respond, but then transfer that data to a ground station. In this case, it was actually in Perth in Western Australia.
Every hour MH370 is flying, satellites pick up an automated ping from the engines. So the plane is clocked until one final handshake on what's known as the seventh arc.
That seventh handshake produced a band, which is an arc, and that's where the science suggests the aircraft would be, somewhere on that arc, but we don't know where on the arc.
Data stopped as the plane crossed the seventh arc, which means that's where MH370 ended its journey. The wreckage is somewhere in the southern Indian Ocean, and as we'll soon reveal, a potential crash site has finally been discovered.
If there is anything down there, we will find it. We owe it to the families of those people to do no less.
It would become the biggest search in history, led by former Air Chief Marshal Sir Angus Houston.
Here's this jet, one of the most reliable jets flying, 777. It disappears and you have loved ones aboard. Well, what happened? Well, we don't know what happened. Where is it? We don't know where it is. We're searching, we're using everything that's available to us, but we can't find it.
Wouldn't it be extraordinary if, after all this time, after all the money that's been spent, after the biggest search in history, that it was a bloke with a ham radio who might have found it?
Oh, gosh, I know, and I think about that, and it's just been hell on earth living in this, you know, surreal world of this plane going missing. And, you know, at the end of the day, yes, it's been a long time, but at least people have still been looking. You know, that's the big thing.
We first met Danica Weeks 2 years ago. She clearly remembered how she found out that her husband was missing, not from Malaysian Airways, but from a reporter.
I got a call from a lady in New Zealand and she asked for Paul. And I said, oh, no, sorry, look, he's on a plane to Beijing at the moment. And she said, so you don't know? And I said, well, no. And she goes, there's been an incident with the plane. Sorry.
I'd like you all now to raise your glasses and join me in a toast to my beautiful bride, Danica.
Paul Weeks wasn't meant to be on MH370. He was on his way to Mongolia to work in a copper mine. First stop, an induction course in Beijing. This is a home video of Paul with his two young sons the day before he left.
At first, he was booked on Cathay Pacific, and it was only a day and a half before he got on the flight that it changed to Malaysian Airlines.
What was the last thing he said to you?
When he was heading off to Mongolia, he said, look, I can't wear my wedding ring and watch on site. Obviously, they're not allowed to, working with big machinery. And he said, so I want you to keep my wedding ring and watch and give the ring to the first son that gets married and the watch to the second son. And I said, oh, don't be stupid, you know. You're going to be fine. You'll go there and come back.
That was 8 years ago. 8 long years of not knowing what happened to her husband. 8 years of not knowing where he is. 8 years of hoping that one day she will finally know. Now there is hope. A potential crash site.
We've spoken about this in the past, haven't we? These kind of moments of false hope that come along the way where, oh, maybe it's found, no, it's not found. Maybe it's found, no, it's not found. And here we are again. So how does this one compare?
Well, yes, we've, along the way, we have, you know, been through so much and it's been a real rollercoaster of hope and dashed hopes. And so I made sure that I read through this and understood it before I put any energy into it. And everything I've read is just so amazing and it's just what we've wanted. I get goosebumps. I'm excited. I know it's crazy to say, but we've just never felt so close. And the time has been there to really get this information and you know, trace this plane. And I feel that this is it. I feel this is it.
Coming up.
When you ditch a 175-ton aeroplane, that's a massive impact.
The plane most likely would have flown further south.
Are you inclined to believe that?
There is credence to this new theory.
He must have been talking with someone. It's just a complete cover-up.
Part of what forms the whole MH370 mystery are all the wild conspiracy theories about what might have happened to it. All you need to do is look online to see some of the more colourful explanations. That it's in the Cambodian jungle, or was sucked into a black hole. Maybe even the Russians have got it. But experts, citing real-life examples, have narrowed it down to a handful of likely scenarios. All of them end up in the same place. How it got there is what divides opinion.
My theory is what's always been is that it was the captain who was responsible. It's done probably as a political protest.
Captain Zahari Ahmed Shah was politically active and a distant relative of Anwar Ibrahim, the country's opposition leader, who was convicted of sodomy a day before the doomed flight.
He was said to be quite upset by that verdict. Now, he was active in the party, but again, there's no claim of responsibility in any of this. But that's one lead. Again, would it be enough for him to take such drastic action without saying he did it? Difficult to say.
If you go through Zahari's Facebook posts, very politically active, very anti-government, so there's a case to be made there.
Captain Zahari was a 53-year-old pilot with 18,000 flying hours. He was a married father of three adult children and a grandfather, known as Ari to his friends and Uncle Ari to his many nieces and nephews.
Hi, everyone. This is a YouTube video that I've made as a community service.
In his downtime, Captain Zahari also made videos for his own YouTube channel. In the background here is his home flight simulator. Is it possible that he hijacked the plane and killed those people?
I absolutely don't agree with that.
Why?
I don't see him as a person who could do that.
But the just-released whisper tracking of the plane suggests otherwise. Using ham radio signals to detail MH370's flight path, it raises the possibility that politics may have been involved in the plane's disappearance.
So he's come up, followed the coast of Sumatra, the east coast and the north coast, down the west coast of Sumatra, and this is the really interesting thing. That is a holding point or a holding pattern.
According to the Whisper flight path, at 12 minutes past 3 in the morning, 2.5 hours after takeoff, MH370 went into a holding pattern.
How can you tell that?
Because
there's
of
a loop
of the shape. Yeah, if you see it larger.
Wow.
So it's a 22-minute holding pattern.
Wow.
There's no reason to do that.
And you have to be manned to do that.
In normal aviation, you would think so. Yeah. Yeah.
There's been a holding pattern that's basically accounted for some 22 minutes of flying.
Yes.
Which would take it off the previous endpoint.
Reduce the distance it could go south.
And this is all according to Whisper.
Yes.
Only the plane's flight recorder will tell us if MH370 did go into a holding pattern.
What do you think was going on for those 22 minutes?
Possible negotiation. Between maybe someone on the ground acting in concert with Captain Zahari, who I believe was responsible. And I think you've got to take into account that his political hero, Anwar Ibrahim, was locked up 5 hours before they left. If I had to speculate, I would say there's a negotiation going on there. You have a new election, you resign, telling the maybe Najib that he needs to resign. So that's a possibility.
The data points on the Whisper technology that's come through shows that there was a 22-minute holding pattern that was undertaken by the plane. How did you react to that?
It was overwhelming, really, because what were they doing in that 22 minutes? And what's the negotiations with the pilot? We should be told about it. We should know what happened in those 22 minutes.
Were the passengers even alive then? Maybe they were, maybe they weren't.
Who knows? Was there an onboard fight with the, you know, the pilots and the passengers? You know, was it another September 11th? I don't know, but 22 minutes is a long time to be going around in circles. He must have been talking with someone. It's just a complete cover-up.
If that holding pattern was not there, let's say, the plane most likely would have flown further south. So that holding pattern actually then puts the plane where we think from the oceanographic evidence where the point of impact was.
Authorities had initially identified a 120,000 square kilometre search area, but they never had an exact spot for where the plane came down. Now there's been a major development in this long-running mystery. Two separate sources have identified the same crash site.
a precise location, 33.177 degrees south, 95.300 degrees east. Are you inclined to believe that, or have you got another point in mind?
I've seen no reason to disbelieve it.
Whisper. Is this the biggest break we've had in a while?
It's the only game in town. It really is. There's nothing else happening. I think it's been shown from the tests that we did that it can be used for this, and I think we've got to give it a red-hot go. The potential search site is actually not that big. It could be done in a few weeks.
How does it affect the eventual crash site?
It brings it further north, and it brings it to the area that Professor Cherry of the University of Western Australia said should be looked at.
That professor was on the money.
Yes.
From the early days.
Very much so.
Chari Patiarachi is one of the world's leading oceanographers. He's also a professor at the University of Western Australia. Analysing ocean currents and drift patterns, Professor Chari has come up with a crash site that is nearly identical to the Whisper coordinates.
So, Professor, after all this time, when it comes to where the wreckage of MH370 is, you might have been right all along.
Well, we have been right all the way along. We were right to say where the debris may end up in the Flaperon. We were the first people to tell where that debris would end up in. So we were right there, and then we were right again now.
The site is 1,933 kilometres west of Perth, more than 4,000 metres underwater. It's mountainous seabed known as Broken Ridge. Despite making this finding just 6 months after MH370 went missing, the professor was never invited to take part in Australia's search efforts.
Why on earth didn't they ask you to be part of the process in the beginning, Professor?
It's very hard for me to answer that. They said that they didn't know I existed, which is probably not correct. But there are lots of contractual things that goes on in, as you know, in government organisations.
They appear foolish now.
Oh, absolutely.
That was, I think, the turning point for me when I realised that it was in the same spot that he had identified many years ago. And I think that's what gave it, gave it ground for me that I think this is it. It backed it up. It's not just, pie in the sky stuff. It's, there's a lot of other theories or, positions where it could be. But this one we have two, and if that doesn't say we need to search again, then I don't know what does.
Is Whisper credible?
Certainly Whisper's credible. The inventor received a Nobel Prize for his work. So it is credible. Whether it's credible to track an aircraft and over these distances is yet to be determined.
But it could be.
Well, there will be a key there one day. Something will help us unlock it.
Angus Mitchell is the new head of the Australian Transport Safety Bureau, the agency involved in Australia's original search mission.
You can see the plane is certainly well within the Australian search area and to the northern end of it.
MH370 had essentially become a cold case for Australian authorities. But in another major development for the doomed flight, the ATSB is now taking another look at it, based on the Whisper report.
One of the things we have done, and it really is in the emergence of this new theory, was to, because it puts the aircraft in an area that we have already searched. So I guess me coming in with a due diligence and a new set of eyes, we are undertaking a review of the data that we hold there.
8 years ago, there was no suggestion of Zahari putting MH370 into a holding pattern. But as we discovered in 2020, there were high-level discussions about the captain going on between Canberra and Kuala Lumpur just days after the plane vanished.
My understanding, my very clear understanding from the very top levels of the Malaysian government is that from very, very early on here, they thought it was murder-suicide by the pilot.
They said that to you?
I'm not going to say who said what to whom, but let me reiterate, I want to be absolutely crystal clear. It was understood at the highest levels that this was almost certainly murder-suicide by the pilot, mass murder-suicide by the pilot.
How long after the plane disappeared did that information become clear to you?
Within a matter of a week or so.
Despite this revelation, the Malaysians refused to name or blame Zahari.
I wish to be very clear. We are still investigating all possibilities as to what caused MH370 to deviate from its original flight path.
In 2018, Malaysia released its final report.
The team is unable to determine the real cause for the disappearance of the MH370.
Again, no mention of Zahari, despite Tony Abbott being told it was murder-suicide.
What was the reasoning that the Malaysians gave you?
Well, it was crystal clear to me that they had a very clear understanding that this almost certainly was what had happened.
If that's true, then that would have to point to some kind of cover-up.
Look, that's not my assumption at all. And I've read all these stories that the Malaysians allegedly didn't want the murder-suicide theory pursued because they were embarrassed about one of their pilots doing this. I have no reason to accept that.
I also met with the Malaysian Prime Minister's wife a month after this happened in Perth, and she alluded to the fact that she believed that the pilot had taken the plane. Now, I got threats on Facebook about how dare you say that, that didn't happen, you know, you're putting words in her mouth. And then for our Prime Minister to come in and say he knew, I was fuming, absolutely fuming. Because what were we waiting for? What were we hanging our hearts out on every day? Every day we'd wake up saying, is today the day they're going to find them? And here's the Prime Minister sitting there knowing, and the Malaysian government knowing, that it was a murder-suicide by the pilot. So what was it all for?
Do you still have that feeling when you wake up in the morning? Is today the day they find them?
No, not so much now, because we're not searching. But it's more of, are they going to find a spot to search again that's going to be enough to push the Malaysian government to search again?
In the 8 years since they went missing, there's been just one certainty about the fate of the 239 passengers and crew. It's the debris from the plane that's been found washed ashore, a sad testament to a tragic end for flight MH370.
When you ditch a 175-tonne aeroplane into a 4-metre swell at 250 kilometres an hour, it's going to break up. It's probably going to break a wing off. It's certainly going to break open the fuselage. I mean, that's a massive impact.
Following the stricken flight, it was Professor Chari who successfully mapped out the locations for much of the debris that's been so far recovered.
Well, how many pieces of the wreckage have now been found, Professor, because of your help?
In total, there has been 33 pieces of debris that has been found, have not been confirmed to be MH370, but most likely would have originated from MH370, and 23 of them we have accurately predicted.
So basically, your information is good.
Yeah, we have confidence in that, obviously.
Was it a mistake not to have Chari Partiarachchi on the team from the get-go?
I think you're asking questions of me that occurred 5 years before I joined the agency. I do know at the time there were experts from Boeing, from Inmarsat, from the DST, from the CSIRO, from geoscience. This was not a case of a couple of people sitting making assumptions.
Could you use him now?
Well, I guess we need to wait and see whether or not there is credence to this new theory. And then it will be something for really for the Malaysian government to consider if we reach to that point and there is a request to Australia. So there's a long road ahead of us before we even consider something like that.
If the wreckage is found, what is it going to be amongst?
Well, we are talking at water depths about 4,000 to 5,000 metres, so 4 or 5 kilometres down. And it is a very rugged, with lots of mountains, if you like, underwater mountains, volcanoes, big cliffs, ravines, etc. So we're in an area which is very close to the edge of what is called Broken Ridge, and that's a 1,000-kilometer underwater mountain range. Very, very rugged.
What goes through your mind when you think that Paul might be in amongst all of that, his remains?
Look, over the years, you know, I really hope to be able to bring him home and have something, you know, to bring home for us. I'm just happy now after 8 years to know where he is. That would bring me some peace, because there is no peace. So just to know that he is in this spot, you know, whether we recover the plane or not, we just need to know. Finding something and knowing where they are will give us a step towards that peace.
Coming up.
It was a considerable search zone. It's the largest in history.
And what that's proved is where the aircraft is not. We know the truth.
They knew what they were telling the press very early on was incorrect.
In your heart of hearts, do you think it will be found?
I do think it will be found.
Byron, it's now been 8 years.
Yeah.
Can you believe that? And we're still no closer to the truth now.
Well, we are. We know the truth. It's not a mystery.
That's your truth.
No. If the Malaysian Prime Minister tells the Australian Prime Minister 4 days after the event that it was murder-suicide, and that ties into all the evidence and the deleted practice flight plan, that's the truth, not some theory.
We rule out a ghost flight.
Didn't happen.
Didn't happen.
No.
In 2014, the then Transport Minister and the Australian Transport Safety Bureau based their search on what's known as a ghost flight or death dive. That assumes that the pilot is dead and that's why the plane crashed.
Left engine shut down.
Two years ago, in a 777 simulator, a plane he used to fly, the former Emirates captain put us into a death dive.
570 knots, that's about 1,000 kilometres an hour. This is going to hurt.
The plane's design meant it would corkscrew, increasing speed until it plunged into the ocean.
So you can see the sea coming up. Oh, I hate the visuals.
That's it. So that's a big crash.
Horrendous.
That's a big crash.
You would have exploded into millions of bits.
To this day, Byron Bailey maintains the search zone was wrong, That's because, he says, it wasn't a death dive. Instead, he believes Captain Zahari was alive and glided the plane as far as possible south. That puts Byron's crash site below the search zone.
All the evidence points to the fact it was ditched. And I'm sure the captain, brilliant captain as he was, brilliant pilot, was trying to ditch the aircraft in as far south, remote location as possible.
My concern in this case, for those who say that the aircraft crashed in a so-called ghosted flight, they made up their minds near the start that this occurred. So they're looking for supporting evidence all the way along the line to collaborate that part. Sometimes it's convenient to turn your back on something as far as governments are concerned.
What are you referring to there?
Countries are very protective about their own organisations, airlines, reputations, etc.
Why would Malaysia not want it found?
For lots of reasons. Their initial response was botched.
Big time.
Big time. They knew what they were telling the press very early on was incorrect.
Even Tony Abbott told us that his conversations with the Malaysian leader.
Yeah.
He knew it was murder-suicide.
Yeah.
And from the beginning.
Yeah, and that's very very embarrassing, particularly if it's done for a political reason.
The fact that there may well be a mass murder event by a Muslim pilot.
Yep, yep.
That comes into thinking, perhaps.
Perhaps, yeah. Yeah, that's very embarrassing too. It goes against the whole narrative of the country, really.
Has your theory changed at all over the years?
No.
Not even a little bit?
No.
We're in cruise at 39,000 feet.
Back in 2020, Byron showed me what he thinks happened to MH370.
Hello, engine's running now. Looks like we have flamed out.
Byron believes Zahari was still alive and still in control of MH370 right to the end.
OK, I'll start to flare now. Then we hit the water. We are dead.
So do you know where it is?
Yeah.
Where is it?
Latitude 3910 southeast 88 18.
If Byron's right, this is it. Just outside the search zone.
That's very specific.
Yeah.
What if you're wrong?
Well, let's just say the ATSB, as part of their searching 40 miles either side of the arc, came within about 30 kilometres of where we reckon the aeroplane ditched. If I'm wrong, then it means the aeroplane's probably been taken by aliens or is sitting in a hangar somewhere in Kazakhstan.
Byron Bailey's crash site is 920 kilometres southwest of the Whisper crash site. That's about an hour's flying time in a 777 jet.
Byron Bailey, he has been a critic of the ATSB for a long time now. His view is that the crash site was always in the southern part of the search zone, just outside it, as a matter of fact. Is he wrong?
As I said, there are a number of theories here. All of them do have elements of truth, and all of them do have elements of evidence attached to them. Until we find the plane, until we can decode, in the event that we can find it and decode what's on board there, those are questions that are going to remain unanswered.
Part of the problem is that people say, well, it's north. Well, no, it's east. No, it's south. Which one do you choose?
Well, that's right, and that's why when they undertook this search, it was looking at the totality of information, and it was using the best expertise around the globe that they had at the time, with the technology they had at the time, to make the best assessment of where the plane most likely went in, and then that search zone expanded, and it was a considerable search zone. It's the largest in history.
They've already searched 250,000 square kilometres over 4 years, and what that's proved is where the aircraft is not. We know where it is. It's never been an accident.
Nearly 8 years on, and Byron Bailey is as passionate as ever about MH370. So much so that he's pushing for an inquest.
238 people were murdered.
Including Australians.
Yeah, six Australians. And I wrote requesting a coronial inquest. And after much prodding, a reply came back saying, we have sent the request to the Department of Justice, Attorney General's Department, for consideration and analysis. Well, what do they know about aviation? Anyway, eventually the reply came back after Tony Abbott had mentioned about the murder-suicide in the 2020 documentary. And the reply said, we need further information. So I said, but isn't the fact that a former Prime Minister says there was murder-suicide committed, isn't that enough information? Never heard another word.
You're quite obsessed with this case, it's fair to say.
Oh, yes, absolutely, because...
Why don't you give up?
No, I'm backed by a lot of people worldwide egging me on, saying, keep going, we need the search to be restarted. That's why I'm here. We want the search restarted in that small area that the Australian Transport Safety Bureau refused to go that little bit further south when they could.
Okay, so just track the rest of the journey after the 22-minute holding pattern.
The Whisper flight path also reveals another possibility about the intentions of Zahari. It shows that at one stage, MH370 was headed towards Geraldton in Western Australia.
This may fit in with other narratives, that maybe the aircraft they were thinking of going to Australia land there and request maybe political asylum. So this point here is where the aircraft is tracking direct to a point that was found on Captain Zahari's simulator.
7 days after it went missing, Malaysian police found, on Captain Zahari's flight simulator, practice runs to the southern Indian Ocean. This just 1 month before the doomed flight. The discovery wasn't made public until it was leaked 18 months later.
Now, the significance of that is that there's nowhere to land anywhere near where that track took it at the end. There are no islands, there's nothing. And so by practicing that flight on his flight simulator, he was practicing what could only be a suicide murder flight.
And in a sad postscript to the MH370 mystery, in 2020, Ian Higgins also went missing. The author and journalist with the Australian newspaper hasn't been seen since. It's believed there are no suspicious circumstances. When we last caught up with Danica Weeks, there was a new man in her life, John.
So, John, bits happened since we last spoke. Got married, how's it all going?
Good, yeah.
No dramas yet?
Of course, no. Always dramas, but we've always come back together.
That's good.
Yeah.
As Danica told us back then, and as she'll tell you now, John is her rock.
You've watched the journey and continue to watch the journey, the mental journey, I mean. Does it get easier at all?
No.
Still there.
Yeah.
It's still there.
Of course it is, yeah. It's not just Danica's journey, it's the boys too. That's the big thing for me is, we've got two young boys that are becoming men that haven't realised yet exactly the weight of what is coming towards them.
Yeah, boys!
The last time they saw their father, Lincoln was 3 and Jack 11 months old.
I don't think any of us ever realised, you know, how long it would be. I thought that this would all be, you know, tied up in a perfect little bow. We'd know what had happened before the boys got to an older age, and we could tell them the truth and tell them what happened. You know, people used to say to me, you need to tell them the truth. And I'm like, but I don't know the truth. So I'd be lying to them. And then if they got to their age now where they're asking questions, and they would say, well, you lied to us, Mum. So I'm happy I didn't give them some narrative that hasn't happened, because we just don't know yet.
Come on, Redders.
Hello. Hello. Come on. Come on. Come on, sit.
It's a massive thing for those two boys that are going to be coming into their own very soon, when they're old enough to understand and realise what has happened, what their anger's going to be, what their... There's going to be so many emotions for them in the future that's going to be very difficult for Dan and I to deal with. Whether they take it one way or the other, it's going to be hard for them, I think.
He wants to play.
He wants to play.
In your heart of hearts, do you think it will be found?
I do think it will be found. When, I cannot tell you.
And where?
And where. You're exactly right. If we knew where, then we would have already been found.
The ATSB boss is reminded of MH370 every day. At work are two empty boxes. He's hoping to one day fill them with the keys that will unlock the mystery of what happened to a plane that just vanished.
They were built to house the flight data recorder and the cockpit voice recorder when MH370 is found. So they've been sitting in my office, and it is a reminder that it remains unsolved. One day, it would be great for them to be full. At the end of the day, everyone, from the families to the investigators that were part of this team, to the worldwide aviation community, to those who travel on planes, want the answers to MH370. And equally, so do I.
You know, this worst part about this is the not knowing. It's the not knowing. You know, what happened? You run so many scenarios through your brain. There's been so many theories, you know, but they are somewhere. We just need to know so we can get some peace, and we can bring our loved ones home and have our memorials and our funerals. And we're still stuck at March 8th. And it's just really horrible. It's a horrible place to be. It's like hell on earth.